Welcome to the Solar Storm. This is your host, Kyle Hunt, coming to you from RenegadeBroadcasting.com. This show was originally recorded on August 2nd, 2015. I had some audio problems on my end, so I've gone back in and re-recorded my questions for my guest, Karen Smith, and we talk about white genocide in South Africa during this episode. So please do stay tuned. It's a very important show. It is a good clue as to where things are headed for the whole Western world. So welcome to the show, Karen Smith.
Hi, Carl. Thank you very much for having me on to talk about this very important subject.
You're quite welcome. Thank you so much for being here. Karen, before we talk about what's going on in South Africa today, can you give us something of a background as to how South Africa came to be with the various waves of migration from Europe?
Okay, so in 1652, Jan van Riebeck landed at the Cape. They were not intending to colonize South Africa at all at that stage. All they wanted to do was build a refreshment station for the ships that were passing on their way to the east, on the East India trade route. And they built little farms and they grew produce. Now, when they landed, there was only one very small black tribe in South Africa. They were the Khoi, who are a kind of a little bushman tribe. They're small, they light-skinned, and they were a very, very small tribe that were resident in South Africa at the time. So what the original settlers did was they traded cattle for fresh produce and other things with the Khoi and supplied the ships that were passing. Well, after a while, they started building houses and making homes for themselves instead of just being living in little huts. The whites decided to build a little settlement there, and it got bigger and bigger and bigger, until they found they were going to colonize South Africa no matter what. Well, the government became very oppressive towards the Afrikaners there. And they, being a very independent race of people, decided that they didn't like living under government rules. They wanted to be left to live their own way. So they climbed into their covered wagons, the same as you had in America, and they started trekking north to find pastures new where the government would not rule them, tax them, etc. And they had been in the Cape 120 years when they started trekking. And that was the first time that they met other black tribes who were coming north to look for fresh grazing for their cattle. So there were no black tribes for 120 years of white settlement in the Cape. They met up with the Zulus at a natural division point of South Africa, where the subtropical area bleeds into a much colder, much more hostile terrain. And that is where they first met the blacks. There were no wheels, there were no blacks riding horses, there were no settlements, there were no libraries, there were no towns or villages. They were nomadic blacks who had come north from as far as Ethiopia and swept everything before them. They killed and destroyed black nations. They killed them, they destroyed them, they enslaved them, they sold them into slavery on their destructive path south. So the story that whites stole the land from the blacks is absolutely not true, and yet the whole world believes that it was.
Well, it wasn't just a one-sided conflict where you had evil white Europeans who were enslaving and mass murdering blacks who just couldn't even defend themselves. There were very bloody battles. One instance was the Battle of Blood River that people can look into. Also, it wasn't just the blacks versus the whites. There was, of course, the conflict between the Boer and the English. Can you tell us more about some of these conflicts, please?
Absolutely. So the Boers in their trek, some of them branched off and went to Natal, which is a very pleasant subtropical area with wonderful beaches, etc., and some of them went towards the Transvaal, which is a more arid, more high-felt bush area. But the British, in their wisdom, they decided to take over the whole of Natal. So those same Boers that had settled in Natal trekked more towards the inland area of South Africa. Now, the Boers founded two republics, the Transvaal and the Free State Republic, which were accepted and agreed on by the rest of the world. They were Boer republics, which were countries which belonged to the Boers. But when gold and diamonds were found in the Transvaal and in the Free State, then the British decided that it was a really good idea for them to annex those two areas so that they owned the riches of those areas. And that was the cause of the Boer Wars. But prior to that, the Boers had met with the Zulu king and had agreed to buy, purchase certain areas from him. Now, he didn't really own them, as you can see, but because the Boers did not want to fight the entire Zulu nation, they met with the king and they said to him, all right, we will pay you X amount and you will give us this area which we will rule on our own. We will not have any Zulus there and you will not attack us. And so it was agreed. But the night that agreement was reached, the Zulu king called in his MPs and slaughtered the entire Boer groups that had gone there to negotiate with him. And that led to a whole bunch more Zulu wars again. But the Zulus had not encountered guns before. So that was the only strength that the Boers had, because they were trekking in very small groups of wagons. And the Zulu MPs would sweep down on them, beating on their hide shields with their assegais and shouting, Bulala, Bulala, which means kill the wizard. And the sight of that to some little laggard, which means to pull your wagons into a circle, they used to do that, put thorn bushes between the wheels to stop the Zulu warriors crawling between the wheels, and they put the women and children and the cattle on the inside of the ring of wagons to keep them safe. And the women and children's job was to reload as the Boers were shooting. And those rifles got so hot that they burnt their hands on the barrels while they were fighting off the Zulus. So it wasn't exactly a war of Boer conquest. It was a war directed against the Boers by the Zulus.
This reminds me very much of the story of the United States and how it came to be, where you had people coming over from Europe who were looking to find a better life for themselves by escaping from the tyranny of government or the tyranny of religion. They were fleeing persecution and oppression and pioneering a new life for themselves in the wilderness. Their intention was not to genocide or enslave the native populations. And so this is what the Boer were doing in South Africa as well, but they kept coming into conflict with the British, who were seeking to gain control over them and the resources of South Africa. Now, during the Second Boer War, there was the first recorded use of a concentration camp against the Boer people by the British. Could you tell us a little bit more about this conflict and other conflicts that arose between the Boer and the British?
Yes, Kyle, the Boer War was basically, if you follow the money went back to Britain. The British wanted, they felt threatened by the Boers owning such rich diamond and gold areas. So they wanted to annex those areas to be colonies of Britain. Now, the Boers had just about enough. They had left. A lot of them were settlers from France and etc. And they had they came in 1652, and they had left Europe because of the Spanish Inquisition that was going on there. So they had fled from religious persecution, and a lot of them ended up at the Cape. Now, they were not going to be persecuted by anybody else. They had just about had enough of this. And the Boers tried to negotiate with the British and keep it on a peaceful level. But the British decided that they wanted that land, they wanted the diamonds, they wanted the gold, and they were willing to go to war for it. Now, the Boers were not a government-paid army. They took their own rifles, they took their ammunition, they took 8 days' rations in their saddlebags, and they went to war. Now, they fought in a kind of a terrorist way, in that they would attack and then withdraw, and attack and withdraw. They were not any of those scripted one army meeting the other army face to face.
I wouldn't call it terrorism. It's more like guerrilla tactics, and it's what the Americans used against the British in the Revolutionary War as well.
I was looking for, Kyle. They fought with guerrilla tactics, and they were winning. There was absolutely no doubt about it, because the British at that stage, they wore red jackets, and they had little drummer boys playing the drums in front of them as they marched. So you could hear them and see them from miles away. Whereas the Boers, with their little Boer ponies and their khaki shirts and khaki uniforms, they were practically invisible. So they would strike these lines of Boers and withdraw and strike again. And the British never knew where they were going to strike again. So they were winning. And the British were getting fed up, because they were a huge imperial power. And a defeat at the hands of this ragtag bunch of people was not acceptable. So what they did was they instituted a scorched earth policy, because the Boers could go to any farmhouse in South Africa and get resupplied and sleep in a bed for a night. And the British knew this, that the Boers did not need supply lines. So they burnt the farms as they went. And they took the women and the children and the elderly, and they put them in concentration camps. Now, those are probably the first concentration camps known to history, were the British ones in South Africa. Now, conditions there were horrific. They were absolutely unbelievable. They were dying by their thousands of cholera and other diseases, and being starved to death, because there was very little maintenance or care given to the people in the concentration camps. So 20% of the Boer population died in concentration camps. And the guys who were fighting, well, they were fighting for their families and for their homes. Their families were in concentration camps. Their homes had been burnt. And although the war was not won on a military basis by the British, it was won because the Boers decided to surrender in order that no more of their families would die in these horrible camps. So that was how the Boer War was fought, and that was the beginning of the enormous rift between the English-speaking South African and the Afrikaans-speaking South African, and that exists to this day.
Was this when the South African state was unified with the boundaries that exist to this day?
Yes, that happened in 1910 at the end of the Boer Wars, where the Union of South Africa was formed, and the two Boer areas were not, it was a very funny agreement. They were not ruled by the British, but they were controlled by the British. So I don't know where the exact difference in terminology
right.
is. But that is what happened. So it was a loose confederation of the South African provinces, which in America you call states, supposedly under their own rule. But it didn't really work out like that.
Kind of like the situation with Ireland or Canada or Australia. A people that realizes it's enslaved to the crown is likely to be a bit more rebellious. So they at least give them the illusion of having freedom.
Yeah, it was absolutely like that. But the British were very pro-black, and that was why the Afrikaners did not want very much to do with the British, because what they did was if blacks stole, which they are famous for doing, they stole the cattle from the farmers, and they attacked the farms then, exactly as they're doing today. And the British would then step in and determine that it should go to a court of law. But in general, they found against the Boer and for the blacks. So the Afrikaner was very, very angry about any form of British rule whatsoever, because their side was swept under the carpet and the blacks were the important people to the Brits.
Well, that sounds a lot like the situation here in the United States today, but we'll get to some of the parallels a little bit later. Could you tell us when the apartheid state really first came to be and what part the British originally played in this?
Well, the Brits started instituting laws against interracial marriage and that kind of thing. So when the Republic of South Africa was formed in 1948 and the National Party came into power, they inherited that system of laws, which was, it was apartheid in its infancy. It was the Brits who instituted the whites-only toilets, the whites-only waiting rooms, no blacks in hotels, no interracial marriage. The Brits instituted those laws. So in 1948, when the Republic of South Africa was formed under an Afrikaans government, those laws were already in place. But what you have to understand also is that the Afrikaners have always been outnumbered by the blacks. The blacks saw that Afrikaners had productive farms, they had cities, they had job opportunities, they had modern things, they had homes. So they flooded into the white areas by their thousands, as is happening again today. But they flooded in so that they could participate in this westernized, bountiful culture. So what the apartheid government did was they invented a word for the laws, and apartheid basically means separateness. So your segregation and the South African apartheid were exactly the same thing. They wanted to separate.
It didn't mean that.
It didn't mean that white people were going around lynching every black person they could get their hands on. Quite the opposite. They were giving the blacks a lot of opportunities, employment, and health care as well.
Yes, Carl, you're absolutely correct. The white society has always been pretty patriarchal. And so the blacks were taken in. The parallel best for me is your slavery. Your slave owners, they housed, fed, medicated, looked after their slaves. Now, although they were not slaves in South Africa, they were treated exactly the same way. And to this day, the South African farmer provides housing, education, food, and an income to their black workers. So they have never been slaughtered, whatever. The murder statistics in South Africa during the apartheid years were 7,036 people per year. Now, under the ANC regime, it's gone up to 135,000 something murders per year in South Africa. So from that, it is pretty plain to see that the claim that the world and the blacks are making, that the white apartheid regime slaughtered them wholesale, is absolute rubbish. The numbers speak for themselves.
Can we go back to the forming of the Afrikaner state for a moment? The British Empire was decolonizing, like a lot of the world superpowers after World War II, as they had been devastated financially, even though they came out as the victors. Now, when the British ceded control to the Afrikaners, was this really an illusion, or did the Afrikaner people really get to determine their destiny at this point? Also, were there continued hostilities between the British and the Afrikaners and the Boer?
Obviously, there were intermarriages between the Boers and the Afrikaners. But being a product of one of those myself, I realize that to this day, as long as the Afrikaans half of the family migrates and speaks English and sends their children to English-speaking schools, you will never be an acceptable Afrikaner. So even though that was happening then, it was a very hard thing unless you spoke Afrikaans. If you assimilated to the Afrikaans side of the family, you would eventually become acceptable as an Afrikaner, not necessarily as a Boer. But the Republic of South Africa was not ruled by Britain at all. They were self-ruling from 1948 onwards. And they inherited a lot of things from the Brits, a lot of the laws that they continued doing, anglicized law and courts, and they had a parliament, the same as, and a prime minister, the same as they had in Britain, because that was the way, the political way that they understood and could do. But it was the National Party government who really hardened up on the apartheid laws, but they had to. It was a matter of self-preservation because they were so hugely outnumbered by the black population that they decided that they would have cities and areas, the suburbs of the cities were white by night. And anyone who was black who was seen on the streets in those parts of the city at night had to produce his dompas, which is a pass saying where you worked and whether you belonged there or not. But you need to understand that America is still majority white, not for very much longer, but it is still. South Africa was only for 120 years of its history majority white. And after that, the Zulu hordes and the Khoza and the Venda started pouring in to every white area. So there were very few whites in South Africa, and they only wanted self-determination. They wanted to be able to live their lives according to their moral values, their religion, their language, and not be infiltrated by other people. So they formed communities where the blacks were allowed. The blacks came into work. The blacks labored, certainly. But they were very seldom allowed there after curfew. And it was a very safe place for both races to live as long as you didn't break the law. Now, during that time, we also gave to the Africans, each tribe had their own homeland. So the Swazis had Swaziland, the Zulus had Zululand, which is an incredibly fertile, incredibly beautiful part of KwaZulu-Natal. And they had their own homelands, and the small base of white taxpayers built the infrastructure, built them schools, maintained their everything for them, built them hospitals, educated them. Now, the blacks say that they had no education under the apartheid rule, which is absolutely not true, because of a lot of the well-off black people today were educated and did university under the apartheid rule in black schools and black universities, which the small white taxpayer base built and maintained for them. So the stories that...
Again, it sounds a lot like the United States, where the black population was actually much better off during segregation. They had intact families, they had a stronger culture, they weren't, of course, listening to the degenerate rap and hip-hop music, and they didn't have as big of a problem with drugs and poverty. But now we see a lot of the blacks in South Africa blaming the Boer for a lot of things. Now, during the apartheid government, were there hostilities at all between the Afrikaners and the Boer?
Well, Kyle, growing up in South Africa, and that was practically—I was born in '53, and the Afrikaners took over South Africa in 1948. That was the beginning of apartheid. So, you know, most of my life I was spent during those years. Now, I never felt any animosity towards the blacks whatsoever. And I don't think we were taught that either. It was just a way of life. You had a black nanny, the same as you had in the USA. She looked after the home, the babies. I do not recall ever being taught or feeling any animosity towards blacks whatsoever. But on the other hand, and also not towards Afrikaners, it was very split up. We had English medium schools. We had Afrikaans medium schools. We had some dual medium schools, but the Afrikaans children went to the Afrikaans class and the English children went to the English class. So I don't recall either towards the blacks or Afrikaans English, I don't recall any animosity growing up. And I don't think that's looking back on a golden childhood where you don't see the things which were bad. I just recall an absolutely great life. The only time I started feeling the problems of the world sanctions and hatred toward us because of apartheid was when I was a teenager and was the swimming captain for the Namibian swimming team. And the only people that we could compete against in those days was Namibia competed against South Africa and Zimbabwe because we were not allowed to compete in sports with the rest of the world. And that was the first time I ever felt the pinch of being a white South African because I could not go to the Olympic Games, which otherwise I would have been able to do.
You mentioned Zimbabwe, which of course was originally Rhodesia. Now, Rhodesia was facing a serious threat from the terrorist forces who were being funded and armed and directly helped by the communists. Even so, the white Rhodesians were holding out very well, even despite the worldwide sanctions. But when South Africa also cut off ties with them under pressure, the Rhodesians were forced to capitulate. What were your feelings when you saw Rhodesia falling?
Well, Carl, I was born in Zimbabwe together with my four siblings. And my dad was a major in the army there, and he did block watch, which means patrolling the block, your suburban blocks at night to make sure that your families are not attacked. And he was dropped on our patio in the middle of one night, beaten half to death, and he was left there to die with our dog's head impaled on the gatepost, et cetera, et cetera. It was very nasty. And I was very young then. My dad just decided that with five children under 10 years old, he could not live like this. So we left and went to Namibia, formerly Southwest Africa. Well, the Russians and the Cubans were training the armed wing of the ANC in Angola, which borders onto Southwest Africa. Now, Angola used to be a Portuguese colony, but they threw the Portuguese out, and they used that as the training ground and the entry point into South Africa to carry out their terrorist attacks. Well, we were held hostage in our home for 3 days by a bunch of these traveling terrorists on their way to South Africa. And we underwent some really bad things. And once more, my dad said, no, this is not how he wants his wife and young children to live. So we fled to South Africa. Now, Rhodesia fell while we were in South Africa, and my parents and many other ex-Rhodesians were very concerned that that was coming to South Africa. But most of them had fought against the terrorists either on the Angolan border or in Rhodesia, because there was conscription in South Africa, and every white guy had to serve 2 or 3 years in the army and then do a camp a year, kind of in perpetuity after that. So all three of my brothers fought on the Angolan border. Now, they were fighting Cubans and Russians, not just the ANC armed wing. They were fighting the Cubans and the Russians there as well. So the government of the day, the thing was the communist threat. It wasn't so much the ANC threat that we were fighting. It was the communist threat on our borders that our boys were sent up to fight. And but life was okay until about the 1970s, when the world started imposing small amount of sanctions on South Africa. And although we felt the pinch in some ways, it wasn't so bad because we were technologically behind the rest of the world. We didn't have TV. We as teenagers, I suppose, we felt a lack of music because the musicians would not play in South Africa, and you were not allowed to play their music in South Africa either.
Oh, wow.
I suppose we felt that in a kind of way. Mozambique was still a Portuguese colony then, and they had a radio station called LM Radio, and we used to hook into that on a Saturday night and listen to the LM hit parade, because we could hear music there that we were not allowed to have in South Africa at that time. So there were ways around a lot of the things. That we felt the pinch the most in gas, because we don't have any natural gas in South Africa, and we had to import it all. So the incredibly creative South Africans started making gas for your vehicles out of coal, of which we have an abundance in South Africa. And that is how Sasol came into being. They also couldn't import army vehicles or any kind of arms, ammunition, whatever. There was a total boycott on that from the rest of the world. So we invented our own. And we had the most incredible company making arms and ammunition that the rest of the world was very jealous of, because we created helicopters, tanks, all kinds of, I'm sorry, I'm not a really warlike person, but all kinds of incredible war machines that the rest of the world wanted access to. So the French and the Israelis and a couple of other countries found ways around the embargoes to get those things out of South Africa.
Even to this day, South African mercenaries are considered some of the best in the entire world. But they just weren't focusing on advancing the military. They were also focused on very great scientific progress. They were very medically advanced as well, with some of the best hospitals in the entire world. The first heart transplant took place in South Africa.
It's quite incredible.
Yes, it was. A friend of mine, Dr. Chris Barnard, he did the first heart transplant. But an interesting aside on that is, since the ANC has taken over, the guy who was an assistant in that operation, a black guy, has claimed that Chris Barnard never carried out that operation at all. It was him, the black guy, who did it.
So, of course, see, yeah.
Yeah, you can see the rewrite of history right there. From the small to the biggest things, the creativity, et cetera, is being taken away from the white, the Afrikaner, and handed over to the black so that they can claim that they did these wonderful things. But that's just a little aside, Kyle, that I don't think very many people know about.
Yes, well, I certainly didn't know about that, but I'm not surprised at all. Oftentimes, white achievements are now credited to blacks, and blacks are said to have basically invented everything of importance, including the Great Pyramids. Now, can we get to how the media has really spun things in South Africa, where you have a convicted terrorist, Nelson Mandela, who was sentenced to life in prison, who then is turned into something of a worldwide hero, a demigod, a saint? It's quite incredible to watch this transformation. Could you tell us a bit more about Nelson Mandela and the ANC, please?
Sure. How do we rise above that? Well, let me talk about Mandela first. So now, Mandela, it's very hard. It's very hard for me, because you get called racist immediately when you tell the truth about Nelson Mandela. But what I tell people to do is Google his trial. That's all you need to do. The entire trial transcript is available online. And you will see that Nelson Mandela pled guilty to 154 counts of terrorism and treason. Now, any country in the world, the penalty for treason is death. But the South African government sentenced him to life in jail, which I cannot see that any other government in the world would have done anything better than that with Nelson Mandela. But while in jail, he was the creator of the armed wing of the ANC. And while in jail, he orchestrated a lot of bombings and murders on the white folk. So in 1981, there were two car bombs at Durban showroom. In 1983 was the Church Street bomb. Now, if anybody knows about that bomb, it was terrible. It killed a lot of people. 10 killed and 217 wounded in that bomb attack. These are the things that Nelson Mandela is responsible for.
It is so hard to get through to people about the truth concerning Nelson Mandela and his necklacing wife, Winnie Mandela. They're seen as these global superstars and hailed as heroes around the world by all sorts of different governments. They've both been to the White House, which I find utterly despicable. And even if you are to tell people about the crimes of the Mandelas and the ANC, they'll likely try to justify it and say that they were fighting against white oppression, therefore it is right. Now, what would have happened to Nelson Mandela if he was conducting these terrorist activities in any other country, a country that wasn't run by white people in particular? What if he had done this against Mugabe? He would have been likely sentenced to death, and not just death, he would have been tortured to death.
Yes, and people see him as this poor prisoner with an axe in his pickaxe in his hand, breaking up rocks on Robben Island, the whole of his incarceration, which is also not true. In 1985, he was offered free release. He could go and live his life if he would renounce violence. Well, he refused to renounce violence, so he was kept in jail, but he was moved to the Polsmoor prison, where he had his own house. He had a butler. He had a chef. He had a terrifically plush life in comparison to whites and blacks in that country. So this picture of poor Mandela chopping rocks his entire life is also false.
Now, when did public opinion start to change to favor the ANC, or did it? And when did you first start to realize that something was really wrong and that you were headed into a bad situation?
Well, in the 1980s is when the violence really started, because in 1976, there was an uprising of the youth in Soweto on the 16th of June, it is still called Youth Day to this day. They rose up because they didn't want to be taught in Afrikaans in their schools. And they rioted and looted and destroyed and burnt tires. And anyway, so the police went in. And that, I think, was the turning point for everybody, was the 1976 Sharpeville riots. At that stage, we didn't have much. When I started realizing in the 80s that something was wrong, we didn't have much to do with the outside world, because sanctions were just about in full swing, because your government instituted real sanctions in 1986. That's when your Comprehensive Anti-Apartheid Act was passed, and it was strict sanctions against South Africa, nothing in and nothing out. And I think that is probably when I began to feel it as a person, because in 1982, the blacks started really, the ANC really started going hard, bombing, murdering, killing, destroying. And it became scary to be white in South Africa. You began to be afraid in your own country, which I'd never really felt before. But I started feeling the impact of those things, because you turned on the TV and there was another bomb and another restaurant and another church and another. It felt like it was every single day that the ANC was killing whites. So I think in 1982 was when the awakening came. Something was very, very wrong. But the feeling was that I think because we were squeezed so hard from all directions, we couldn't get anything from the outside world. We could not compete in sports. We had nothing. The world outside had nothing to do with us, would have nothing to do with us. The only people were Zimbabwe and Namibia, who had their own civil wars going on. So it's a country with a very small tax base, a very large amount of people to take care of, and no outside aid whatsoever, not going broke. And I believe that our government the NP government was not doing so very well when they came up to the referendum in 1992. But the squeeze had been felt for a very, very long time by then, at least years. And you can only tax the tax base so much before they will protest. And the tax base in South Africa was mainly white. And so the NP government was in a bit of a bind because they had to support all these black homelands. They had to have a really strong police force and army to fight these internal terror attacks. And they had a very small tax base to pay for it all. So they were being squeezed incredibly hard. And I resent, I kind of understand why the national government started talks with Mandela and the rest of the world. Now, your government said that unless we lift apartheid, they were not going to lift sanctions. And that was a red line. It was not going to be crossed. Nobody was going to break that rule. And we were squeezed hard, really, really, really hard. The Nationalist Party, with help of the rest of the world, sold the whites down the river. But the referendum, the question was, do you support the negotiated reforms begun by State President F.W. de Klerk 2 years ago? So that was the question. And the understanding of that referendum was that there would be power sharing. There would be a tripartite government with whites, other colors, and then blacks. And the other colors included Indians. So that was the agreement. Now, 85% of the electorate turned out to vote, which is an incredibly high number anywhere in the world. And of that 85%, 68% voted yes, that we should continue the negotiations begun. We did not say hand the country over to the ANC.
Okay, so it seems like the South African whites did not actually want to cede their country over. We're told that pretty much they had a change of heart. They realized that they didn't want to be oppressing the blacks anymore. In fact, it seems like they were really tricked into giving control over to the ANC. And I understand how at the time when you're facing so much violence, all of these bombings, and you're facing international sanctions, you've got the United States coming out and decrying you as the most evil country in the world, that you want to find a way to become part of the world again. You want to find a way to be prosperous, to have ties with other nations. And so I'm guessing a lot of people thought that this could be the only way forward, that perhaps things will start to get a little bit better. Unfortunately, they were sorely mistaken if they actually believe that things have only become much, much worse. Oh, but at least the blacks now have power. Is there anything else that you'd like to add about what life was like under the apartheid state?
I could speak to you for a whole night on what it was like. It is the most beautiful country in the world. As Cape Town has once more this year been voted the most beautiful city in the world. You have got everything. You have got mountains and snow, and you've got big beaches, the best beaches in the world. You've got the best surfing in the world. You've got seafood like you can't believe. We had a wonderful infrastructure. We had everything worked. That's the best I can tell you. Everything worked. We had the best hospitals in the world. We had the best doctors. We had the best schooling, the best education. We were up there in the top 10 in the world. We were the best at everything, and we had a beautiful, beautiful country. And then came 1994. But I also want to add to you that obviously some of those people who voted in 1992, they did want to atone. You will always have that group of people who, you call them libtards in the States. I don't think we have the word in South Africa. But you will always have that group of people who are ashamed of who they are. They obviously voted from firm belief that that was the right thing to do. The rest of the people voted because, well, we've got to bring an end to this.
I've heard that the churches in South Africa played an instrumental role in bringing an end to apartheid. Is that the case from your own experience and knowledge?
I would say the English churches, the Afrikaner churches, which are in Netherlands, Reformed Dutch Reformed Church, they clung strongly to the fact that the Clerk was correct in history and they were doing the right thing. But I do think that the English churches, because I know a lot of pastors were exiled from South Africa, and they were all from the English churches, that they possibly were instrumental, yes, in convincing people to vote yes.
Is there anything you can tell us about the relationship between the communists who were agitating violence against the whites in South Africa and Jews? Because it seems that Jews such as Joe Slovo, who is pictured in front of the communist flag with Nelson Mandela, played an instrumental role in bringing about the fall of the apartheid state. And Nelson Mandela's lawyer was himself a Jewish man.
Kyle, I'm not very, very versed in that because my focus was more on the English Afrikaner, the British area, so I'm not really, really versed in that. But I do know that the diamonds and the gold belong to Anglo-American, which was a Jewish-controlled company, and they were and are the richest company in South Africa. So there has to have been some influence there because Anglo-American obviously wanted to come back to South Africa and not be chased out by sanctions. So I'm sure there was Jewish influence there, and there was a lot of Jewish influence in the ANC, but that has never been my focus, so I'm not qualified to speak on that.
Let's turn now to the violence that has taken place against the white South African people since the fall of the apartheid government. The Boer farmer has been targeted for a great deal of violence, and this just seems so insane because the Boer farmer is responsible for feeding the entire country. So these blacks are really cutting off their own food supply. They take control of the land and they don't even know what to do with it.
Absolutely. Prior to 1994, there were 120,000 white productive big farmers in South Africa feeding the entire country. Well, today there are 30,000 left. Now, the population has grown exponentially in the last 20 years because the blacks breed unbelievably, but also because of the refugees flooding into South Africa from all over Africa. So the black population has grown exponentially. The white population has shrunk, and the farming productivity has shrunk by two-thirds or more. So the situation is dire because South Africa is a very, very drought-stricken country. We have seven years of relatively wet years and 7 years of dry years. And right now we're in 7 years of drought. So the food supply has diminished anyway. And they have killed over 4,000 farmers in the last 20 years. Now, that seems to me, as you've just said, a very stupid thing to do because the farmer feeds you. And you only have to look across the road to Zimbabwe to see that they are starving. They are starving to death because of a combination of...
Did you say 40,000? 40,000 farmers have been killed?
4,000. Approximately 70,000 whites have been killed, but 4,000 documented farmers.
I've seen the pictures of blacks holding up the sign saying, kill the Boer, kill the farmer. And, of course, they're starving because of it. Are there blacks in South Africa who have realized that this is the wrong way to go, that things were much better under white rule? And are they actively seeking to bring whites back into positions of power?
A lot of the older blacks who have lived under both rules are now saying, no, 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 this was a big mistake because under the apartheid rule, we all had houses, we all had jobs, and we had food. And now things are terrible. But the biggest problem is it's not those older, that's not the older blacks. It's the born frees that are the problem. It is the blacks who were born after 1994. Now, they are... The youth of today, and the black unemployment rate in South Africa is well over 50% amongst the youth. So they are so disaffected, and they never lived under apartheid, so they don't know. And they have been indoctrinated into the fact that whites were the oppressors and their parents suffered and etc. So they are the vocal opponents of the whites, and the most dangerous, as I see it right now, are the born frees. So even though the older Africans are saying, I wish those days were back again, they don't have that much power anymore.
The same thing is happening here in the United States with youths going out rioting, burning things down, looting, raping, torturing, murdering. In South Africa, under black rule, the country has become the number one rape capital of the world. South Africa, of course, is falling apart in many other ways as well. Largely, it seems, due to this policy of affirmative action against the minority white population, where blacks are given all sorts of opportunities to fill these different roles. And this state-sanctioned racism against whites has resulted in all sorts of industries and companies just failing. There have been power outages, rolling blackouts recently in South Africa. So could you tell us a little bit more about how much this country has devolved?
There are three things you've spoken about there. We are the rape capital of the world because there are reported 3,600 rapes a day. Now, they say that only 50% of rapes get reported, so double that. 7,200 rapes a day and more. Imagine that were happening in Texas, because South Africa is very little bigger than Texas. Imagine that.
What percentage of the victims are white? I imagine that they are being disproportionately targeted.
The figure given, and I can never guarantee any figures coming out of South Africa, but the figure given on the rapes is 20% black on white per day.
And what percentage of the overall population are whites in South Africa?
3.5 million whites and 70 million altogether. So the whites are less than 8% of the population.
So the official figures do show that white women are being disproportionately targeted by the blacks in South Africa for
One
rape.
One of the things you need to understand about black on white rape in South Africa is that the Sangomas, who are the witch doctors, have told the blacks in South Africa that the cure for AIDS, which is, well, I think South Africa is one of the biggest AIDS-suffering populations in the world. I think Nigeria beats us, but I'm not positive. Anyway, the Sangomas have told them that the cure for AIDS is to have sex with a virgin. Now, that it basically equates to white young girls. So the situation of rape in South Africa is not quite what it is in the USA. It is attacks on children and teenagers in order to cure AIDS. So not only are they raped horrifically and have to live with that if they live, they then have to fear that they will have AIDS as well.
It's absolutely terrible. Can we now talk about how the discrimination of whites has led to severe economic hardship and how many, many whites in South Africa are now being forced to live in squatter camps in the most horrid of conditions?
I'll need to go back kind of to the beginning, because in 1994, you know that they wrote the Constitution of South Africa, and it has been lauded as the best constitution in the entire world. In your own Congress, it was held up as a better constitution than the American one. So in the Constitution, it says that there will be no discrimination by race, color, creed, sexual orientation, nothing. There will be no discrimination. But in the paragraph under that, it says, except in the case of affirmative action. So that very wonderful Constitution absolutely contradicts itself in two sentences. There will be no discrimination except against the whites in the case of affirmative action. Now, South Africa is the only country in the world that has 119 race-based laws excluding the whites from the job market in order to protect the majority. The mere fact that those laws exist is a travesty, because they are the majority. How come they need protection from the minority? But the outcome of those laws is that any company that wants to do business with the government has to abide by the quota system, and they get points on that scorecard for employing blacks, for having black managers, for having black owners, for having black partners, for doing business only with black businesses. So that's their BEE scorecard. Now, if at the end of the month they have failed on that scorecard, then they can't do business with the government. So any contract that you want, you cannot have with the government. And if you're a supplier to somebody else, that means that the somebody else also cannot have contracts with the government because you do not comply with those laws. So the outcome of that was companies started playing a numbers game because white women were amongst the previously disadvantaged, together with coloreds, Indians, blacks, etc. So if a white husband or father lost his job, it was still okay because the wife was considered previously disadvantaged and could earn an income. Well, the companies played such big games with that that the government decided to do two things. They declared the Chinese to be black, so they didn't have to abide by those laws, and they tightened up the BEE laws and declared that white women were no longer in the previously disadvantaged list. So when people started getting fired or laid off, it was always the white women that went first. So now you have a white household where the father couldn't work, the wife was carrying the slack, now she can't work either, and you have a family. So the first thing that's going to happen is you have no social services whatsoever for whites in South Africa. That is also a law, but I'll speak more on that later when I come to the orphanages. So the family now cannot support themselves. They can't pay their bond. So they move out of their house, and they're living in their vehicle on the side of a very dangerous road where they are prime targets for blacks. Now he can't pay his car payments, and he can't put gas in the car, so the car is repossessed. Now they have nowhere to live. So they are now once again living on the side of the road in a makeshift, if they were lucky enough to have a tent, good. If not, they're living under cardboard or whatever will keep them from the elements. But it's very dangerous living there. So the white dispossessed people started forming informal settlements. Normally, they've been given the land by a kind farmer or some white person who have taken pity on them. So they're not squatting on the land. They've been allowed to live on the land. So they formed settlements where they could have strength in numbers and grow little gardens and whatever. But these settlements do not have power, they do not have sewage, and they do not have running water. Now, in the beginning, it was a rarity to see those settlements. The blacks have always had them, and they've only grown under the ANC government. But to see a white one was shocking. Well, as I understand it, and again, it's really hard to give a number, they're between 85 and 119 white informal settlements in South Africa. Now, one of them, to whom I'm particularly attached, is the Munsiville camp. Now, those whites were living in a settlement, and the government wanted the land for something else. So they sent in, they gave them a two-day warning and sent in the bulldozers to bulldoze their existing shacks down.
Wow.
A South African activist, Sunette Bridges, was outraged by this and got a court interdict, giving them time to find another place to live before their houses were bulldozed down. Now, the government decided in their infinite mercy to give these whites a piece of land. Now, the piece of land that they gave to the whites is an unreconstituted garbage dump at Munsiville. It had only recently stopped being used as a garbage dump. So you can imagine what that property looks like. Now, the government, once again, in their infinite kindness, put up some shacks for these white people. They are four walls and a roof made out of corrugated iron. There are no windows. There is no ventilation. There is no flooring, and they are not attached to any foundation. So they're just plonked on the top of the earth. And it's very hot in South Africa in the summer. So your floor is a garbage heap. You have no ventilation, and there are holes in the roof. So it was the very first rains. Those floors of garbage turned into garbage mud. And this is where these people were expected to raise their children and to live. So they moved in, and the first night that they were there, there was a horrific storm. And it blew a whole bunch of those houses right over. It blew them down the road. And the rest of them, of course, were knee-deep in mud because of the holes in the roof. They also had no toilets. So the government kindly gave them one, you call it a porta-potty here, I think, one porta-potty for three houses. But the bucket in that porta-potty is a 10-gallon bucket. Now, with three families using it for maybe a week at a time, that bucket overflows in no time flat. But that is the toilets which the government has given them. There is one tap per 300 people, a faucet, so you could get running water. They have provided one per 300 people in that particular squatter camp.
Now, if this was happening to any other people on the planet, any non-white people, the countries of Europe, the United States, Canada, all the other progressive nations would be opening up their borders, opening up their wallets and saying, hey, refugees, come, come here for a better life. We'll take care of you. We'll give you welfare. We'll give you health care. We'll give you a house. We'll give you food stamps. We don't want to see people living in abject poverty. You'd have organizations like Amnesty International going out and trying to intervene. But of course, if these countries were to admit white South African people as refugees, it would be an admission that there is a genocide taking place in South Africa, and they can't let the news about that get out to the world at large. This must be kept a secret. So could you tell us about any efforts to get refugee status for the South African whites and get some kind of international recognition that aid is severely needed?
Okay, I just want to go back a bit on what you were saying about a genocide happening in South Africa. So a very brave lady, Ariana von State, who runs a site called Censor Bugbear, she was a journalist in South Africa, and eventually when she gave up working, she went back to Holland. Now, she has been keeping a blog site and a record of every white South African murdered by blacks since the beginning of time. So she went to Genocide Watch, to Professor Gregory Stanton, and said to him, look, there is a white genocide happening in South Africa. It's a slow genocide, so it's not thousands of bodies a day, and the world is turning a blind eye. I need you to go down there and investigate. And eventually, he was a very loud voice, anti-apartheid. So he's not a real right-wing person. He's not a racist. He's not anything. He was a huge voice, anti-apartheid. So he went to South Africa, and he's now been there three times. And he went on a fact-finding mission, and he said the following. The Boers must not give up their guns, which, as you know, have been confiscated from them. The Boers must not give in to this terror. They must have a political voice, and other countries must take them in as refugees. Now, no other country has ever acted on that. So to come to your second point, refugee or asylum status for South Africans, no. The only way you can be a refugee or an asylee is if the United Nations and or, I can't remember what the other group is, designate your country as unsafe for a certain group of people. Unless they do that, then no country will take you as a refugee. Now, asylee status is a little bit easier, but again, you are hitting your head against a brick wall because according to the government, in every country, South Africa is a safe country, so why would you want asylum? But the anomaly to that is that the United States took in 1 month 320 black South African refugees and not any whites. So there are people who have been given asylum in the States, but I think there's a whole 160 in 21 years. I know of five families who are applying right now, and I'm trying to raise money to help them with their legal fees, but the chances are slim to nothing. A South African family with four American children was sent back to South Africa last year, and the entire family were murdered within 6 weeks of getting back there.
Let's take a break here and listen to audio of a talk show from South Africa where they're discussing an online petition to grant South African people refugee status and give them the right of return to European countries. It has garnered some international attention and quite a few signatures as people around the world are very concerned about the fate of their South African kinsmen. So we'll listen to this, and when we come back, we'll talk a little bit more about solutions and also what is happening in Orania. Stay tuned. We'll be back with my guest, Karen Smith, right after this.
22 minutes before 7 here on Morning Live, a reported petition posted on the change.org website to the European Commission to allow white South Africans who so wish to return to Europe to save South African whites from ethnic cleansing. Now, this petition also extends to whites living in Zimbabwe and Namibia. The campaign is reported to have been initiated by a man named Rodrigo Hernaus de Campos, and he is from Brazil. Now, to talk about this petition, we're joined in studio by Angel Jones. She's the CEO of the Homecoming Revolution, and Dr. Dan Ruert, he is the director of Praag.org. Good to have both of you. Thanks so much for coming into the studio. Just up front, what was your reaction when you heard this, Angel?
Fury, to be honest. I think what got me was this phrase, ethnic cleansing, that really made me furious. I mean, there are going to be these radical bunches of unknown people who start these crazy things and have these responses online, a lot also from people outside of South Africa who've never been to South Africa. You do get these crazy pockets of things happening, but what got me was this phrase, ethnic cleansing. And those kinds of sensationalist rubbish can go in a really big way across the world and cause all the good work we're doing in South Africa to actually be really questioned. So yeah. Fury was my huge first reaction.
Dan, your first reaction?
Well, yes, I was slightly surprised by this, but more so by the impact it had and the fact that it became very popular, because you know I start a lot of petitions myself and sometimes they don't go anywhere. But this one obviously got a lot of support because it struck some sort of a chord out there. But I think when this phrase, I mean, people in South Africa use extreme language all the time, and I think that maybe ethnic cleansing, it is a strong term, but when you look logically at where South Africa is going with all the anti-white legislation that we've got and the measures and so on, there seems to be a sense that whites are not welcome in the long term in South Africa, and they should find some other place in the world to go and live. A lot of them have gone to Australia and these places. And the European Union and many European countries have actually supported very radical movements in South Africa, like Mugabe's ZANU-PF. I mean, ZANU, he came here not so long ago where he said he didn't want to see white faces, and he was cheered for that. And about a week ago, the European Union announced that they were going to give him another 240 million euros. He's getting, last year in 2014, he got $1 billion in aid. So there's obviously, from outside, a lot of support for this kind of anti-white radicalism represented by Mr. Robert Gabriel Mugabe, who also now happens to be the president of the African Union.
Yeah.
So the question is, what do these European whites want us to do? I mean, well, what is their long-term project for us? Because they seem to be in the driving seat. They're dishing out the aid. They're supporting radicalism and these sort of very anti-white ideologies that you find in Southern Africa. You know, where is our real home if it's not here?
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, that's the reality. But I think at this point we'll focus in on South Africa as opposed to what's happening in Zimbabwe and our neighboring countries. Because, I mean, it is petitions like this that, look, the reality is that almost 25,000 people have actually signed this petition, which makes me think, you know, where... That
like Dan said, maybe it did strike a chord. But who is this striking a chord with? Because, gosh, I mean, I'm just looking around. There are three whites sitting around this table. I would never sign a petition like this because it's nonsense, in my opinion. But who do you think that this is speaking to?
Well, what, judging from the comments on the site, over half the commentators are people living in Norway, and the UK, and Europe. So,
I don't know. They don't even live in the country.
What we see at Homecoming Revolution, in the past 5 years, 359,000 South Africans have returned home.
Yeah.
The majority of those are white. 90% of the people we interact with are delighted to be home. We're sitting in South Africa with 800,000 scarce skill vacancies, where it doesn't matter what the color of your skin is. And as far as we at Homecoming Revolution view the whole BEE legislation, until there is something better that helps us close this Gini coefficient in this country and bring up those poorest of the poor into the labour market, we don't see a better option. I don't see it as anti-white whatsoever. I see it as a way to make a more equal society in South Africa.
You know, the other thing that I'm reading about this guy, I mean, we were all sitting around this table saying, who is this guy, this Brazilian guy who has started this petition? So I find a little article that says the man spearheading the campaign has absolutely no roots to South Africa. Approached on social media, the network engineer and coder was asked why he had chosen to help South African whites. He went on to say, I just thought I could help white South Africans avoid total ethnic cleansing and the right to return to Europe could be a way to solve this problem. I mean, should this even be getting any attention whatsoever, Dan? And I know that you are quite radical, but
I'm not radical, I'm just logical.
So logically, does this deserve attention?
No, probably not. But there is a sense that there's this whole sort of Rainbow Nation cliche that you had in 1994. I mean, the editor of the Business Day has even written, about 2 weeks ago, he wrote a column. We said that all of this has fallen by the wayside, and there is a sense that everybody is blaming, all the groups in South Africa are blaming each other for things that are going wrong. And we're also seeing how yesterday there was a court case where the Gauteng Education Department, they're attacking all the Afrikaans, the remaining Afrikaans schools in this province, and they want to impose English on them and change the demographics of the schools and so on. And there's a lot of people are very upset about that. So is there any, in Europe something like that would never happen because their minorities have protection and there's minority rights, language rights and so on. So it has struck a chord because I think the white minority in South Africa has a sense of being under threat and of being legislated against. I think Flip Bass from the Solidarity Trade Union at their conference a few weeks ago also made the point that we feel that we are being legislated against in South Africa.
Just final words from you as well, Angel?
Yes, right now South Africa is in crisis. We've got a problem with our crime, with our health, with our education. Hence, if there are empty schools which do have places for children to come into, I fully support the idea of bringing more children into an Afrikaans emptier school and teaching them in English. Right now, yes, we've had an awful 5 months in South Africa. I think tensions are high on all sides. I think to sit and blame other people and have these radical thoughts is just crazy. What I do want to end on is saying that, do you know, Deanne, where all human beings come from is Africa, is the cradle of humankind, which
Absolutely.
Is right here. So if anybody's going to call home and come home, they should all come
here. There you go. Let's leave it there for this morning. Dan, thank you for talking to us. Angel, thank you very much for talking to us. Somebody writes to me on Twitter and says, this is Biggie, saying, Leanne Manus, will you leave South Africa? You want to know the answer? Absolutely not. You're going to have to push me out of this country to get me out. And I think this is nonsense, to be honest with you. All right. All right.
Karen, do you have any comments about that audio we heard there before we move on to some other subjects?
You know that motion of sticking your finger down your throat? Well, that's how I feel right now about that. She herself said, we had a terrible 5 months in South Africa with riots and burnings and xenophobia and necklacing those infiltrators and the rolling blackouts and now the water shortages, and they're going to do rolling water blackouts as well. So you will have your water turned on when they feel like it and off when they don't feel like it. So she herself said that we've had 5 terrible months. Well, I'm very glad for her that that's all she's had in the last 21 years, because South Africa is a mess. And the guy who started that petition, he's somebody like you, Kyle, or like the guy across the road who has now heard the story of what is going on in South Africa, may never have set foot in the country, but is heart sore for the fate of the whites there, because it's coming everywhere. And if we don't take a stand in South Africa, the rest of the world is going to be inundated. You're not going to, well, it's happening, and they haven't seen it coming, and they are suffering the consequences. Whereas if they'd been watching South Africa and what was going on there, they may have been able to stop it in their own country. Anyway, so the guy who started that petition was probably some really heartful about seeing it in South Africa, in Europe, in the U.S., the same thing happening. And felt sorry for these people because he realized how badly outnumbered they are. So for her to say absolute nonsense herself, when a third of the white population is in those squatter camps, sorry, that they are concentration camps in miniature, they're in those squatter camps, 1 million of them, as far as we are able to count, 1 million white people out of 3.5 million population is living in those squatter camps.
Wow.
And women turn around and say, this is absolute nonsense. Please, she lives in some ivory town somewhere and she should not be allowed on air. But it's the media thing again.
What is the best solution here? It's the age-old question of fight or flight. We've seen white flight taking place all over the Western world, where communities become too diverse, therefore dangerous and just hostile, and white people are forced to flee, and diversity just keeps chasing them down. So is the solution to try to get as many of the white South African people back to Europe, back to the United States, to a safe place where they're out of imminent danger? Or is it somehow to stand up and fight? If we were living in a healthy society in the United States, we'd be sending missions down there to help the white South African people. But we're not living in a healthy society. So we're actually doing everything we can as a government, as a country, to ensure that this continues, that this is covered up. So what do you think, Karen? Fight or flight here?
For me, the question is, would standing and fighting be of any use? Because their firearms have been confiscated in the very early years of the ANC regime, and so very few of them are armed. Yes, they are armed whites. Some of them have got their licenses, but others have been waiting 20 years to get their license approved for the firearm that they own. In the meantime, that firearm has been sold by the police to the criminal element, or even rented out by the day by the police to the criminal element, who are the police. So what good would it be for such a small handful of people so widely scattered around the country? I don't know that's the answer. But a lot of them wouldn't leave anyway. They've been there 400 years. Their families have been there. Why should they be forced to leave? And also, if a third of the population is living in abject poverty, where even the Red Cross doesn't help them, because they've been told that they'll be forced out of the country altogether if they help whites, so they only help the blacks, what hope is there for people like that to even think about leaving, because they will never raise the airfare?
Good point. Well, it seems like it's up to the rest of the world to help out the white South African people. Right now, we're raising awareness, but what other solutions are available?
Well, there are two things. Now, you wanted to talk a little about Orania. Orania is an absolute, completely white town. They bought a town that was a ghost town, and they built it up from there. And it is a completely white town. Only Afrikaans is spoken. Afrikaans is spoken in the schools. They have their own form of currency, which is used in the town. And obviously you have the South African money if you go outside of the town. But they have their own banks. They have everything. They have an absolute zero crime rate. And they have been going, I think they have 1,000 residents now. I might not be telling the exact figure, but I believe they have 1,000 residents now, and they are doing very well. But they themselves admit that they do not have any protection. So if the blacks decided to descend on them in hordes and wipe them out, that would be easily possible, because they don't have even a police force, never mind an army. So the Afrikaner wish right now is for what they call a folk start, a place of their own, where they can live according to their own moral values, their own language, their own laws, and be left alone to so that they can survive as a group of people, because the Afrikaner, they're the last ones in the world, and if they're wiped out, there will be no more. So that is what they want right now. And it is kind of entrenched in the CODESA agreement at the time of the handover to the apartheid rule, to the ANC rule. They said that they would look at the possibility of a folk start for the Afrikaners. Well, obviously, 21 years later, that has not been done. And I don't think it's going to happen, because the blacks depend on that white tax base to support the rest of the country. So I don't know that they will ever, as it were, let our people go, because Pharaoh is getting too rich off the backs of those people and can't afford or won't survive without them. But the Front National have recently been accepted by the United Nations as a registered group to speak on behalf of the white South African, and they are hoping to raise enough funds to be able to go to some meetings this year and discuss the possibility of a folk start or sanctions against South Africa again. So there is some hope in that regard, because Front National, despite all the other white political groups saying that the United Nations is not listening, when Front National went to the United Nations, they found that there has never been a request to the United Nations to listen to the white side of the story. So they will get that done. And then they went to, in Australia, they went to the Unrepresented People's Council and were accredited to speak on behalf of the white South Africans there as well. And they were there a month ago and have given presentations to that body on behalf of the white South Africans. So all is not absolutely lost for white South Africa. If the world would join together and either take them all as refugees, in which case only the libtards must stay behind, those who want to stay must stay, and those who are and face the consequences of that, and the rest of them must flee, or the world must stand up and say, look, we wanted everybody to have their own homeland under apartheid rule, so now why can the whites not have their own under ANC rule? Now, that is the first prize for the Afrikaner, is to have their own place, their own space, their own recognized by the world state where they can continue their way of life without being murdered at every turn.
Mm-hmm. Now, Orania seems to be doing very well. I've heard conflicting things about Orania, though, that it's basically just something of a PR campaign, or that basically the government could just shut them down at any point. It seems like it's a very precarious situation for the people in Orania, where they're basically allowed to live in this all-white bubble that could come crashing down at any point. So could you comment on that, and also what the public sentiment has been about Orania? I'm guessing this has inspired some of the white South African people, but probably also angered some of the black folks who think that these white folks need to be integrated and need to share their wealth.
Yes. Well, Orania is a grand experiment. It really is. But as I say, they could not defend themselves against anything. They pay taxes to the ANC government. I mean, they don't. They're not a self-ruling little town. They have their own city council, but they still report essentially to the ANC government. So yes, they could be shut down tomorrow, and there would be little or nothing they could do about it. So given the land reinstatement acts in South Africa, it would be a wise thing for some from the other half, not from a white person's perspective, but for some black tribe to claim that their ancestors grazed goats on that piece of ground, and then they would go to the land claims court and Orania would be given back to the blacks. Now, they already had one land claim on Orania, but the guy who made the claim was happy to be paid in cash, So they settled in finance instead of handing the Orania back to this tribe. But it could happen again, and they might not be get off so lightly next time. Now, because of Orania, they have a sister city, and I can't remember its name right now, which is the same principle as Orania. And then Sunette Bridges took some of those people, instead of them going to the garbage dump that I've told you about, she is building a place called Clanfillet, which is called a place of new beginnings. And she will, in the beginning, house and have work for 100 white South Africans who were previously in a squatter camp. Now, her Clanfillet has been very successful as well. The people have worked together. They've planted vegetables. They have opened a roadside stall, so they make jams and preserves, and they sew bags, and they make jewelry, and they sell it there. And it has thus far been a success. But then again, it is totally isolated. It is controlled by the ANC government, and it could be taken away from them at any time. And when you have a million people living in dire poverty, 100 of them being lifted out of that is not a big score, as it were. So
right.
They are in themselves very successful experiments, but they don't seem to me, and that's my own opinion, they don't seem to have a very big shelf life.
Hmm. Well, could you tell us about how people can help? Are there any organizations that people could donate to, that they could perhaps send clothing or food or in some other way help? From what I've heard, it's hard to trust that the funds or the materials will not be stolen by the black government.
Exactly. Now, the problem with sending donations to South Africa, the first one is the post office. Now, the post office has been on strike for 6 months, and the post is piled up, and they've burnt it and thrown it in the streets, and it was complete chaos. There was no postal service whatsoever in South Africa for a matter of months. Now, they've gone back to work, but I don't think that it will ever be reasonable, because the post office is now absolutely destitute and 16 billion rand in the hole. So the postal service in South Africa will never be any good. And if it does get to a post office, anything you send will probably be stolen then and there. So it will never reach where it's going. In the unlikely event that it does not get stolen and is going to reach the person you sent it to, they have to pay tax on the value of that package. So if you put a low value on the package, the government will open the package and put their own value on it, and before your charity can take control of those goods, they have to pay taxes on it. So you're actually not helping them by sending them goods, which are desperately needed, but every door has been closed to send them there.
Well, I just hope we're able to get control of the United States or a European country and then just physically go down there and ensure that these people are taken care of. You know, bring barges ashore, of course, with protection. That is what I'd like to see happen in an ideal world. Unfortunately, we don't live in one, at least not yet. But any other ways, then, that people can help?
Okay, so this is also a contentious subject, Kyle, so expect a lot of hate coming your way because of it. But there are a lot of people and a lot of so-called charities who are making money off of the misery of the white South Africans, and very little money makes it to where it's going. So I have investigated the charities that are available. And my charity of choice, they have people, volunteers, all over South Africa. They work in every single squatter camp. They collect donations. They transport them to the squatter camps. These people are not paid 1 cent. Every single donation goes to the charity, and it goes to where it is needed. And I give you my word of honor on that, because I know the people involved in that charity. They have a web page. They are called South African Family Relief Project. So their web page is AFRP and then SA for South Africa. You can go to their webpage. They have a donate button. And I need to tell you that you can feed a family of four in those squatter camps on $20 a week. So don't think that your donation is too small to give. It is not. You can feed an entire family on $20. Because of the exchange rate right now, it's worth a lot of money in South Africa. A rand is 12 or 13 rands to the dollar. So any dollar you give will relieve somebody. Now, this charity also put floors in, concrete floors, on those garbage heap houses, and has taken that squatter camp particularly under their wing and are looking after those people to see that they survive the winter. So they are buying medicines for the children, taking them to the doctor when needed, providing them with milk, formula, etc. They're also trying to get them more taps, more faucets, and more running water. So it is a well worthwhile charity. The other one, of course, is Klein Filet, which is Sinead Bridges. You just have to Google Klein Filet, and it will take you to her webpage, explain to you exactly what they're doing, what still needs doing, and you can donate there. There are a couple of other South African charities which I'm a bit iffy about, and then there must be others that are worth donating to. But you know Africa, and you know how it goes there, and you can be scammed very, right, very easily. So those are the only two that I can, with confidence, recommend people give to. Or if you're feeling extremely charitable, I'm trying to bring a South African couple to the States, and we've raised the money for their visas. They will be in their passports shortly, and I'm only a couple of $100 short on their airfare. I have a home for them when they get here. I have a vehicle for them, and any excess money which is donated will go to their legal costs for applying for asylum. So that is my personal PayPal account, which is Cooks, C for Charlie, OOKS for Sugar, 595 at yahoo.com. And once they get here, they will write to every single donor and thank them personally. You can be sure that every penny of that money will go towards those people.
I'd say some people out there are feeling a little bit more courageous or giving. Are there ways for people to actually get down into South Africa and volunteer, help out, or is this not allowed?
It is allowed. I know of an American volunteer over there in the white squatter camps right now, but the problem is you have to have money to go do it because the South Africans cannot support you and because they're poor. And the people who need you the most can't support you, but they can put you in contact with a whole group of people where you can help. But the problem is it's expensive, and it's expensive to live, and it's dangerous to live. So if you were really adventurous, contact me at that same email that I've given you, and I will put you in touch with people in South Africa that are aid groups and that will help and probably put you up for a while once you get there. But that's the best that I can tell you.
And what about the more rich people in South Africa? Are there richer white people who are sitting by and watching this happen, not really doing anything, not putting up any of their money? Or are most people down there destitute?
No. There are two classes of whites in South Africa. There's no middle class anymore. There's the white, the rich, and the abjectly poor. There is no white middle class anymore. But the rich white people, of whom I have to tell you I was one when I lived there, they live in protected circumstances. They live in gated communities where there are guards at the gate. They don't drive on roads where you will pass a squatter camp. They are not subject to quite the same amount of fear. And also, they probably have money offshore and have foreign visas in their passports. So if it really hits the fan there, they can leave anyway and turn their back on it. But for now, they are making money, and they will keep on doing that until such time as there's no more left to be made, or until such time as violence hits their own family, in which case they will change their libtard views and become like the rest of us that see reality.
Any final words for people who are living in, say, the United States or in other countries where diversity, as they call it, hasn't gotten so bad. Anything you can tell them to wake them up or inspire them to stand up while there's still time?
Well, if you look at the rest of the world, those self-same Africans who wanted to be decolonized are now fleeing in their hundreds of thousands to where? To white countries, the very same people that they wanted rid of. But once they get there, do they integrate? No, they don't. What do? They bring their African ways. So they live on the dole, and they have their hand out at every turn, and they bring their murder, rape, drunkenness, drugs, all of that they bring with them until your country is overwhelmed. And you will see it in Sweden, you'll see it in the USA today, because a lot of the influx of other people are raping and murdering here right now. I've heard of people in America with oil, a girl in America that was raped and oil poured down her throat and set alight. So it is coming. With these people from Africa, it is coming. It is in America already. It is in a lot of Europe already. And unless you stop it and stand up and do something about it, you are going to be the white tribe of South Africa in no time flat. You're going to be outnumbered by them, and you are going to be the minority that will go through all of this that South Africa has already gone through, and the end has not come yet for the whites in South Africa. So you need to be watching people, and you need to stop it while you still have the power to do it.
I agree. Karen, thank you so much for joining me on the show tonight. I really appreciate it.
Thank you very much, Kyle.
Stay in touch, and please let me know if there's any other way that people can help out.
I will let you know if I think of any. Thank you very, very much again.
Oh, you're welcome. Thank you. And thank you out there for listening. Please stay tuned to all the shows here on Renegade Broadcasting. Folks, please, please do what you can to help the South African whites. Raise awareness. Share this show. Donate. Go there. Get courageous. Let's think of a way to help them and at the same time also help ourselves. I think we'd be benefiting greatly by having these very industrious and intelligent and caring folks in our country. So perhaps you'd be willing to help them come and seek asylum. Again, thank you so much for being a part of RenegadeBroadcasting.com. I'll talk to you all again next week.